الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله وحده، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. We commence by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending complete blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them, and may he bless every single one of us, and may he bless our offspring, those to come up to the day of Qiyamah. May he keep them steadfast on the deen, and at the same time may he grant us all acceptance the day he takes us away. May he make it easy for us, and may he grant us Jannah. Ameen. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, the nation of the Muslims in Madinatul Munawwara had been built on the foundations of goodness and piety. The masjid had been built, the first one, upon piety, known as Masjid Quba. Thereafter, the second masjid to be built was Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi, or Masjid Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, within Madinatul Munawwara. These are the blessed masajid built by the most blessed of hands, the hands of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He took part in building the masjid. And this is why it is a sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only to contribute towards the building of masajid, but to take a moment to pick a brick or two up with your own hand and lay it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. This is also the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are so weak that in our lives, we can only fulfill a few of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whereas there are hundreds of thousands of sunnah, we as ordinary human beings would be unable to fulfill all of them. And this is why, do not belittle what someone else is doing, thinking that you are the only one serving Islam. Perhaps they are also engaging in the sunnah, and by you saying I'm the only one serving Islam, you would be insulting the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is far broader than just one or two things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding of the deen, and may he make us from amongst those who can support one another. As we ended off yesterday, making mention of the points that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had stressed whilst he was in Madina Munawwara at the beginning. These were, firstly, I made mention of the issue of education, to the degree that, as I said, after the war, after one of the wars, he actually issued an instruction to those who were captive, saying that if you can teach 10 from amongst us to read and write, we will free you. This was the importance given to education by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And on top of that, the importance of a good upbringing, the importance of good character and conduct, cleansing of the heart, ridding it of hatred, malice, jealousy, and so on, and ridding it of any of the bad qualities. This tazkiyatun nafs, and clarification, meaning purification of the heart, something very, very important that every single one of us needs to consider and needs to engage in fact. Because with us, we are human beings, and we are not from amongst the anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who were protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, safeguarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are ordinary human beings. Shaytan comes to us and tries to divert us. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam constantly reminded his companions to cleanse their hearts, to remove hatred, to remove malice, jealousy of one another, and so on. And above that, to love one another. And the brotherhood should always remain. These were some of the prime teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, over and above worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obeying the instruction of the messenger. So as this happened, let's take a look at some of the first ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam memorized in Al-Madinatul Munawwara. These were words that came out of his blessed mouth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they were put into practice, they were taken very, very seriously. As I go through these words, remember, these are the words that built the nation. Let's, every one of us, look into ourselves, how close or far we are from the same words, and we will be able to see whether we are good or whether we are just from amongst those who pay lip service to the deen saying that, you know, I follow Islam, but in actual fact, we are following something very far from Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when he was asked, Ayyul Islami khair, which of Islam is the best? Now this question means, what is the best thing I could do as a Muslim? And the answer came several times in different wordings, all heading towards one conclusion. And every time a different point was raised. And on this occasion he says, تُطْعِمُ الطَّعَامَ وَتُقْرِئُ السَّلَامَ عَلَى كُلِّ مَنْ عَرَفْتَ وَمَنْ لَمْ تَعْرِفْ. He says, to feed food to whom? Starting with the poor, those who are poor, those who are in need, those who are hungry. We will come to another hadith just now, inshallah, which clarifies this as well from another angle. Feed food to people, be considerate about people, and spread salam, the greeting, as well as peace. Spread the greeting to those whom you know, as well as those whom you don't know. That's a very important point. Today, point number one we lack. We'll greet, but we only greet when there is a maslaha, or when there is something for ourselves that we find we might want to gain from this person. If there is a person downtrodden, who perhaps we fear he might ask us for a thing or two, we start off by turning away and we don't even greet. We greet people, mashallah, because of their wealth. This is what has come nowadays. Sometimes this happens. We greet people because of their status, but we leave those whom perhaps had we greeted them, the acceptance from Allah would have been far greater than having greeted a whole community of wealthy people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So this is the importance of salam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. To those you know, to those you don't know. The fact that they are Muslimin, they deserve the greeting. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who understand. So at that time, the Muhajirin and Ansar, they knew that these are from the Ansar, these are from the Muhajirin. But initially, they had to be acquainted with one another, and they had to get to know one another. And this is why salam was important to everyone. You know them, you don't know them. You greet them, they have a link with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another hadith, he says, لا يدخل الجنة من لا يأمن جاره بوائقه. Amazing. He will not enter paradise whose neighbors are not protected from his harm. Amazing. This was building Medina Munawwara, so the neighbors were looked towards. One narration says, when you are making some stew, add a little bit more in it to give the neighbors. Subhanallah. With us, never mind giving the neighbor something good, we give them something bad. May Allah protect us. It happens. Let us hope that we can be from amongst those who don't do that, and we can be from amongst those who understand the powerful words, he will not enter paradise whose neighbor is not safe from his harm, because that is your neighbor. And if each one has to fulfill this, the whole community will be people who fulfill the rights of one another, because we are all neighbors of someone. Another narration, powerful words, al-muslimu man salima al-muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi. A Muslim is a person whom all the Muslims are protected from the harms of his tongue or his hand. Look at the powerful words. Today we are in an age of rumor and gossip. It becomes so juicy that the marination of the chicken that we happen to braai or to put on the fire, barbecue chicken, that marination is left one side. The juiciness of the statements of rumor about our own brothers and sisters is far greater. In Ramadan, in the condition of fast, and rumors are flying. And Vodacom has made it quite easy to do that. May Allah protect us. Allah safeguard us. Wallahi, we need to be careful. A true Muslim is he whom all the Muslims are safeguarded from the evil of his tongue and his hand, which means physical harm or verbal harm. Not at all. It goes deeper than that. We are not even supposed to be holding ill feeling in our heart for one another. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. If there is something people are engaged in that is bad, we should try and talk to them directly and try and help them and so on. And if there is something that we cannot do anything about, we can at least make a good prayer, feel it in our hearts that this is wrong, but we don't need to go around spreading tale, rumor and gossip, because what happens to a person who spreads rumor, it comes back to haunt him at some stage later on. May Allah protect us. And this is one thing we don't realize. Sometimes we suffer in life without knowing that it is the result of a rumor we spread about a friend of Allah. And this thing came back to us to haunt us, and our lives are upside down and we don't even know. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. These were the building stones of the foundation of this nation. And another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُحِبَّ لِأَخِيهِ مَا يُحِبُّ لِنَفْسِهِ. None of you are true believers until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. So you love goodness for yourself, you should love it for others. You want everything to be good for you, you should want it for them. And you should make dua for them, or wherever you can and you are able, you should help them, open the doors for them. And Allah will open your doors. This is why the hadith says, Al-mu'minuna karajulin wahid. The true believers are like one man. If his eye is sore, his whole body is restless. If his hand, one organ is paining, his whole body will be restless. These are the words of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another narration of a similar meaning, he says, Al-mu'minu lil-mu'mini kal-bunyani yashuddu ba'duhu ba'da. A believer, his relation with another believer is like that of a wall, of a building. Each brick strengthens the other. Without one, you find the whole wall or the whole building is weak. So we need to hold each other up, and we need to make sure we stand as a wall, as a building. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Then he says, لا تحاسدوا ولا تباغضوا ولا تدابروا. In one narration he says, كونوا عباد الله إخوانا. Do not be jealous of one another. Do not hold hatred against one another. Don't turn away from one another. These are the building stones of the foundation. The building stones within the nation of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us acceptance. And he says, you should be brothers for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then something very important. He says, whoever is spending time helping his brother, Allah will be helping him for that period of time. And another narration, كان الله في عون العبد ما كان العبد في عون أخيه. Allah continues to help a person for as long as that person is engaged in helping his brother. Subhanallah. Look at this. So people began to help one another. They loved one another. They opened their doors for one another. They were feeding one another. They had a good feeling for one another. When they had problems or crises, they would resolve it immediately. The hadith continues to say, whoever removes a Muslim from a difficulty of the dunya, Allah will remove him from the difficulty of the akhirah and the day of judgment when he needs it more. Subhanallah. We sometimes create problems for people. Forget about removing them. It's a fact. This is why you find degradation of the nation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Then he says, وَمَنْ سَتَرَ مُسْلِمًا سَتَرَهُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever covers the faults of a Muslim, of a believer, Allah will cover his faults on the day of judgment. Look at this. Today we itch to expose people, because that is the Western thinking, the idea. The minute you see something, announce it to the world. Go to the press, tell the whole world. That is the Western idea, that everyone should know everything about every single person. So what happens? A person might have turned to Allah after they have done something wrong. The world continues looking at them with an evil eye. And who are they to judge? Allahu Akbar. Whereas the Islamic teaching is, you see something wrong, you don't go and expose, you resolve the matter. If you love a person, see something wrong, you don't go and start telling the whole world. You go to them and you say, my brother, this is something that was wrong. Please rectify it. I am your brother. I care for you. And then if the person rectifies it, you are brothers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love. And the two of you will be resurrected together as those who love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, granted a special place on the day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment. So this is of extreme importance, and we learn a lot from it, and we learn how today we have different thinking because of the environment we live in, and we have this love of exposure of people, and we think that there is goodness in it, not realizing that if Allah were to expose us, none of us would be seated here this evening. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may He cover us in the dunya as well as in the akhirah. Then he says the powerful words, irhamu man fil ardi yarhamkum man fis sama. Have mercy upon those on earth, and the one in the skies will have mercy upon you. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy upon you. Imagine these words. The Jewish people are listening to them. The mushriks are listening to them. And at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Ansar and Muhajirin are learning from them. And they become merciful, compassionate. Their hearts open up and soften up at the same time. Then he says, a mu'min is not one who eats to his fill whilst his neighbor is hungry. Look at that. Words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Neighbor, hungry. Then he says, one of the levels of iman is to remove a harmful object from the path of people. Amazing. You drive your vehicle, you notice a brick in the middle of the road. Between you and Allah, if you were to stop your vehicle, ensuring safety, obviously, and you were to spend a moment to remove that brick solely between you and Allah, it's a sign of iman and belief in your maker. Because you would not like fellow human beings to be harmed by something you saw. Perhaps they may not see it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. And in this way, you may never know how many times you were saved from being harmed by something on the path because of others before you who removed the object, before you even came there. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, be careful. Be careful of those two types of people who are cursed. Who are they, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He says, الَّذِي يَتَخَلَّى فِي طَرِيقِ النَّاسِ أَوْ فِي ظِلِّهِمْ. The one who relieves himself upon the path of people. Where people walk, they relieve themselves there. So now there is a stench and a smell, they are cursed. These are cursed by the people who walk. And at the same time, the others who relieve themselves in the resting places of people, the shade where people might take a bit of rest, and you find you go into the shade and you want to busy, you know, you want to lay your picnic, for example, and there you have a human being before you who has just relieved himself. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam warns us. Imagine, today we speak of environmental cleanliness and pollution and so on. These were beautiful teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the basics. And this is what community is based upon: cleanliness and compassion and the feeling for one another. And this is why he says, any Muslim who has clothed another Muslim who did not have clothing, Allah will grant them a special clothing on the day of Qiyamah and in paradise. Subhanallah. It means people who are without clothes, people who don't have something to clothe themselves, if you help them, you get a special clothing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And anyone who feeds another who is hungry, Allah will feed them from the food of Jannah, subhanallah, the food of paradise. So this is not just feeding the wealthy. This hadith is specifically feeding those who do not have food. Look for them, hunt for them, go and give them, and Allah prepares for you food, subhanallah. And the last part of that hadith, it says, and whosoever quenches the thirst, whosoever quenches the thirst of a person who is thirsty, who doesn't have that drink, and whosoever quenches them, Allah will grant them a drink from what is known as Ar-Rahiqul Makhtum, which is the sealed nectar, special drink of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant that to us. So these are some of the beautiful narrations that were the building point of the nation in Madinatul Munawwara, over and above the treaties and the various agreements that we spoke about yesterday. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us realize and look into these ahadith and many more, and ask ourselves, how close or far am I from these teachings of Islam? And if I am far, what am I going to do about it? Remember, as I always say, this is the month of Ramadan. We have a few more days. We have already passed the halfway mark, if you look at it carefully. And when we exit Ramadan, are we going to be from amongst those who exit it without having taken anything from it with us as we exit? So every goodness, we leave it in Ramadan and we walk out. What was the point? We'd rather have the month of Ramadan if it has changed us and it has woken us up and it has made us develop our good qualities and it has made us eradicate our bad qualities. Then we have achieved from the month of Ramadan. If not, we have just wasted our time fasting and standing in salah. As the narration says, how many people who fast, they achieve nothing besides hunger and thirst from the fast. How many people who stand at night in prayer, they achieve nothing besides getting tired and staying awake. May Allah not make us from those. May Allah open our doors. Let us get back to the situation in Madinatul Munawwara. Now Quraysh, they started understanding and realizing what has happened. Makkatul Mukarramah was empty. They had no one to poke. Basically, they had no one to harm. They had no one to actually make life difficult for. So what did they do? They wrote a letter. Who should they write to? Because now the leader of Madina, Madinatul Munawwara, is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you recall, we made mention of a man who was about to be appointed as the leader. His name was Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. Quraysh wrote a letter to him and told him a few words that, look, you have given asylum to a wanted man who is wanted by us. If you do not hand him over to us, we are coming with a huge army to wipe you out. Basically, these were the words. We are coming with a huge army. We're going to fight your men and we're going to enslave and capture your women. That's what we're going to do. So when Salul got this letter, he was very happy in a way. Because to him, he said, let me make a big noise about it so that I can get Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam out so that I can be the leader once again. But as soon as he started making a noise within certain circles, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being informed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what did he do? He got up and went to Salul and his people and said, you have overreacted regarding the letter that came from Quraysh. You have overreacted. Do not overreact to it. This teaches us a lesson. Sometimes something small, we don't understand, we overreact. We get very excited about things. So we make a mountain, as I always say, from a little molehill, a big mountain. And yet, if we had asked those who had knowledge and we asked those with experience, they would tell you, brother, just ignore this. Don't worry. It's minor. It's small. Just leave it. Allahu Akbar. We have to face negativity in life. No one can say, I have a smooth life with no negativity, because then what was the point of Jannah, paradise? Paradise is going to be a place where there will only be positives, no negatives. If the worldly life was the same, then what was the point of going to paradise? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deeper understanding. And so when they wrote this letter, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then reacted upon the reaction of Salul, things started calming down. But the whispering was still on. No, you see, these people are going to come and attack us. In the meantime, something else had happened. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, who was one of the leaders of Al-Aws, as we have made mention of, and a Sahabi, he went for Umrah. And this was the habit of the people at the time. Now this man had gone to Makkatul Mukarramah, and he was a Muslim. When he went there, Abu Jahl, in fact, he stayed with Umayyah ibn Khalaf. That was a person whom he stayed with. And Umayyah bin Khalaf, these people used to pass Madina Munawwara on their way to Ash-Sham, to the northern Arabian region. And when they used to take their caravans, they used to pass Madina Munawwara and wait for a while. And thereafter, when Sa'd ibn Mu'adh went to Makkatul Mukarramah, as he is making tawaf, Abu Jahl asks him, or asks Umayyah bin Khalaf, who is this man? He says, this is Sa'd. Sa'd meaning the one from Yathrib, the one from Medina. He says, oh, if you were not with this man, I would have stopped you and blocked you. You would not have returned back to your people. You have given asylum to a wanted man. Look at the same statement from the same people coming again to a different person. You have given asylum to a wanted man. You have given him a base and you are protecting a person who is wanted. We would block you and stop you. At this point, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh said very loudly, if you try to do anything, you will be blocked from going up to Ash-Sham. All your caravans, we will stop them, block them, and you will have to go back. Your trade route will be over, closed. Your business, gone. Now they were worried, they had to keep quiet once again. But They knew that now the mushriks of Mecca are preparing war against the believers who are in Medina Munawwara. There were many still in Mecca. And the mu'mineen, they were not so many. There was a head count done of the people who were able to participate in war if war broke out. And 1,500 men were counted at that time in Medina Munawwara. So that was the population of the men and the boys, or should I say the young men and the older people who were fit to fight. 1,500 people. And so Quraysh knew that they had large numbers. But subhanallah, whilst they were preparing, on this side, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was visiting different tribes. And he was visiting different areas around Medina Munawwara, signing treaties with the people to say, look, we are the Muslims, we are a nation, new nation. We are going to protect you if anything happens to you. And if an army comes to attack us, we will fight together. Subhanallah. So this was just an agreement that was struck, and more little groups of people and little clans were joining, and more areas were joining the Muslim forces. In the meantime, something amazing happened. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to have bodyguards around him. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum did not leave him. They had bodyguards around him, so much so that once he speaks about how he had such a good sleep when Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu was standing guarding him. Until Allah revealed verses where Allah says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ بَلِّغْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ رَبِّكَ وَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلْ فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَهُ وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الْكَافِرِينَ
O Messenger, get up and convey the message. If you don't do so, you will not have fulfilled your duty. And remember, Allah will protect you from the people. When those verses were revealed, he immediately told those who used to stand around him, you can go away, Allah has guaranteed my safety, my protection. Subhanallah. So the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, making mention of those who used to stand around him, this was only to the point where the verses were revealed, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses that I will protect you, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed those who used to stand around him to leave. And this is when sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they knew that he is protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing will ever harm him except and until the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed it. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at that time verses were revealed to him which were very, very important, because Quraysh, they had a bad habit. They began to visit Medina Munawwara quietly, and they used to try and inculcate in the hearts and minds of the people that, you know, this man is like this, like that, and they were causing problems. On one hand, you had Ubay ibn Salul, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. He had his group of people. They were visiting the mu'mineen and the believers, you know, those who had believed newly, and they were trying to distract them and find fault in Islam and so on. And as for the Jewish people, there was a treaty with them, but still deep down they used to support Ubay ibn Salul. Anything that happens, they would quickly support him, so that they tried to create problems in the midst of the Muslims, but Allah protected the Muslimin. And then Allah revealed verses. Up to that stage, Muslims were not allowed to fight, no retaliate, no revenge, and they weren't even allowed to defend. If someone had usurped their wealth, they had to just go away. Up to that point. There Allah revealed verses.
أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى نَصْرِهِمْ لَقَدِيرٌ
Permission has been granted to those who are being fought to defend themselves and to revenge and retaliate. For indeed Allah is all able to grant them victory. These verses brought a smile on the faces of the believers. Their wealth was usurped, their properties usurped, their people were killed. They were driven out of their homes. And the mushriks still did not leave them alone. They wanted to come to Medina to attack them. Now they were granted permission to defend and to revenge. Revenge meaning you were booted out, you can go back and you can boot them out and you can take back whatever was taken from you. Whatever was taken from you, you can take it back. And at the same time, anyone tries to harm you now, you don't sit back. You can actually revenge. Subhanallah. You can defend yourself. And that is the right. It's a common right that we have. If anyone wants to attack you or me today, with whatever I have, I need to stand up and make sure I defend myself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. So when these verses were revealed, Quraysh, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started in an amazing way finding out information and getting to know the place, getting to know more about Quraysh, preparing to attack. Why preparing to attack? Very simple. This attack was not an attack to spread Islam as people think it was. No. It was to go back to Quraysh who killed from amongst us and go back to Quraysh who had usurped our wealth and our properties and driven us out of our own homes. We need to go back and get it, because even the wealth that they have is contaminated with ours and whatever belonged to us. Subhanallah. So anytime there were caravans that moved north towards the Syrian region, what was known as Ash-Sham, it was the right of the Muslims to waylay the caravan and to take every bit of property, because all that belonged to the Muslimin. It was usurped from them. Subhanallah. So this was revenge. It was retaliation for what you did for the last 14 years. For the last 14 years, you harmed us, you attacked us, you killed us, you did this, you did that. And now we are just allowed to defend. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started sending little platoons and reconnaissance missions of a few of his companions. And he sent them into different directions. We want to start off making mention of some of them. But before I do that, fighting came down in four stages. First, only Quraysh were allowed to be fought, nobody else. So at this stage, when these verses were revealed, the Muslims were only allowed to fight Quraysh, no one else. Then slightly later, they were permitted to fight thereafter the mushriks from amongst the Arabs who fought them. The mushriks from amongst the Arabs who fought them. And thereafter, anyone who sided with Quraysh in their war was also fought by the Muslimin, even if they were people of the book who broke their treaties with the Muslims. And the last category, those who started war. Anyone who started fighting, we were allowed to go back, retaliate, and at the same time, we could revenge, we could fight them, preparing an army, and go back to attack them. Like, for example, there were instances where the messenger of the Prophet ﷺ was harmed and was killed. He sent a whole army to fight those people. Why did you kill our messenger? Who are you? So you started the war, not us. And this is what happened. So Rasulullah ﷺ, the first platoon that he sent, he was not a part of it. But in Ramadan, in the first year of Hijrah, he sent what is known as Sariyat Saiful Bahar. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib was sent with 30 men. Only to find out information, to gather intelligence. The idea was to gather intelligence. This is what it was. These people were not warriors as such. The Muslims were calm people, but they had to learn. And they started gathering information. So when Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib was sent towards a place known as Saiful Bahar with 30 men, in order to see and to check the caravan of Abu Jahl, that was returning from Ash-Sham, that had 300 strong men. So now Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib went with 30 men. As they went, they got there, they saw the caravan, and now the two parties came together. And obviously two hostile parties coming together face to face. There was a man known as Majdi ibn Amr, and he had a treaty with both sides. So he got up and he said, you know what, no fighting here, we don't want to fight. You people go back, and you people go back, we don't want any war and any fighting. So Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib came back to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, and Abu Jahl went safely to Makkah Al-Mukarramah. But it did something. He went back to Mecca and he was worried that these people are brave. They are powerful. For the first time, they are preparing some retaliation. So it sent a very strong message, although it was mainly to gather a little bit of intelligence. The first flag that was lifted by the Muslimin, you see, every time there was an army, they had had a flag. The flags were mainly white. So this flag was by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam given to Hamza radiallahu anhu, and he had given it to one of the members of the army. It was a white flag. It was a little platoon. They had gone, as we made mention, just 30 men. The second little skirmish that took place, or we call it a little platoon, a sariya, something, a small reconnaissance mission in order to gather a little bit of intelligence. It was what known as Sariyat Rabigh, which was also in Shawwal in the same year, first year of Hijrah. And the leader was Ubaidah ibn al-Harith radiallahu anhu. He went with 60 men in order to check the caravan of Abu Sufyan. That was a much bigger caravan that was coming with 200 men, but it had a lot of wealth and it had a lot of merchandise. So the two met and they threw spears at each other, but this one fled and the other one came back to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. There was no killing as such. There were just a few spears and arrows that had flown from one direction to the other and from the other direction to this. And from Abu Sufyan's little group of people, two of them came into the Muslim camp and returned to Madinah Munawwara. They were Muslims already, but they had joined the caravan going on business with the idea of making the hijrah undercover. You see, hijrah was not easy. So if someone wanted to make hijrah, it's like sometimes, you know, we have, let me give you a simple example, come to my mind now. You have, for example, something going on, a religious function going on somewhere, and a person really needs to do a bit of business there or something, and you find a man saying, you know what, I want to go to the religious function. He jumps in, he gets a free lift. When he goes there, he's doing something else. This example was the other way around, where these people were going for business and the Muslims, two of them, jumped in with them saying that, you know what, we're coming. Not making mention that we want to jump off in Madinah Munawwara. It so happened that this platoon had met them and they returned with the Muslimin, subhanallah. The third little platoon that had gone out, Sariyatul Kharrar, and that was in Dhul-Qi'dah of the first year of Hijrah, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas went with 20 men and he had also aimed for the caravan of Quraysh. Why were they aiming for caravans of Quraysh? As I said, because that wealth was ours. That wealth was contaminated. These people stole our wealth. They had stolen our properties. They had benefited so much. They drove us out of our own homes. Anything we could get hold of belonged to us. They had fought us. We need to go back. So this is why Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu went, and as he got to the place that he had supposed to go, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him not to go beyond that. So when he got there, he found out that the caravan has already passed, so he came back. But there was another benefit of all these little platoons going out. They gathered lots of information about the areas, the places. They understood the outskirts of Medina, the path, the roads, and they also started gathering how Quraysh move, the movements, how much they take when they go, when they come, and so on. All this was intelligence being gathered. A lot of benefit by these little platoons that were going out. We have then the first time that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself went out was in the month of Safar, in the second year of Hijrah. He went out what was known as Ghazwa. Ghazwa is like a skirmish or a battle. It could refer to a battle if there is fighting that takes place. And sometimes it's just a skirmish because the two armies may not have fought or the two parties may not have actually clashed. So Ghazwat al-Abwa, that's the name of the first group of army men that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went with. He prepared this army and he walked with them. He went with them as their leader. And it was also referred to in some books as Al-Widdan, Ghazwat Widdan. So Al-Abwa, you hear the name, and you also hear the name Widdan. In Safar, the second year of Hijrah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took 70 men, all of them from amongst the Muhajirin. And he also aimed for Quraysh and the caravan that was coming back. But he had not met the caravan and there was no fighting that took place. He spent 15 days out and he had had a flag that Hamza radiallahu anhu was holding and the flag was white. And when he left Medina Munawwara, one might ask, who did he leave behind as a leader there? He left behind Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu the first time he went out, and that was the first participation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. No war had taken place. Then you have the second participation was known as Buwat, Ghazwat Buwat. The reason I'm making mention of all this, many of us think that Badr was the first war. The reality is no, there were so many skirmishes before that. And one thing led to another. And the Battle of Badr was only after certain things had happened. And how did they happen? We will come to it inshallah in a few moments. You have Buwat in Rabi' al-Awwal, second year of Hijrah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went out with 200 men. And Umayyah ibn Khalaf was coming back from Ash-Sham with 100 men. But sadly, they had already passed the caravan. So they learned a lot. They went to these areas. They met the people. Every time they were coming back, like the first one, Al-Abwa, when the Prophet ﷺ was coming back, he took a lot of time to visit the tribes, to visit the people, to meet them, to spread the word. Some may enter Islam, but more importantly, a lot of peace treaties were agreed upon between the parties, because what you find, when there is peace, thereafter Islam spreads. And in this particular case, there was so much peace. So many of these little clans and groups started joining the forces with the Muslimin and pledging allegiance to them, especially a peace treaty that was struck between the parties. Then what had happened is something known as Ghazwatu Badrin al-Sughra, the Battle of Badr, but the small one, the minor one. It's not the main battle that we all know. It was a skirmish in a place known as Safwan. And this place, what had happened is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Rabi' al-Awwal, in the second year of Hijrah, went out with 70 men. And why did he go out? Very important. There was a man called Karz ibn Jabir al-Fihri. He had come in with a few men to Medina Munawwara, and he went into the farms and he stole some of the sheep and he stole a little bit of the property and he was rushing back. When he rushed back, announcement was made in Medina that this is what happened. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gathered 70 men and he went after this man in order to retrieve and to get back what he had stolen from Medina Munawwara. Subhanallah. So this was the reason why he had gone. And they had gone to this place of Sifwan, which was very, very close to Badr. In fact, it is also called a part of Badr. And when he got there, subhanallah, this person had already skirmished and he had run away and there was nothing much that could have happened. But the beauty is the area of Badr was already seen and everything that happens around there was already known. So when they went to Badr after that, they already had known what Badr was all about and they were acquainted with a lot of the areas close to Badr. And then we had a war where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took part in, which was known as Dhil Ashira. And this Dhil Ashira was in Rabi' al-Awwal, in the second year of Hijrah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in fact, they had intended to gather information of the caravan of Quraysh that was heading north. And they found that they had missed it. They calculated when it would return. This caravan of Abu Sufyan. This caravan of Abu Sufyan. And what they did is, on its return, this is when the major battle took place. Subhanallah. So they calculated, we missed it going up, but when it comes back, we're going to get it. Why? Because what it had in it was a lot. They had a lot of merchandise, so much that the Muslims did not want to lose out on what was rightfully theirs. Subhanallah. It was returning what was theirs to them. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thereafter prepared an army. And that would be the army which finally took part in the battle known as the Battle of Badr, the main battle that we all know. But before we get to that particular battle, there were two or three things that happened in Medina Munawwara. One is, before the Battle of Badr, the direction of the Qibla changed. So Allah instructed His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 16 to 17 months after he had come to Medina Munawwara, that we are seeing that you are looking for the direction in prayer, and we are instructing you to now face Makkatul Mukarrama. So at that juncture, the verses were revealed.
فَوَلِّ وَجَهَكَ شَطُرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ.
Turn your face towards Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Makkah Al-Mukarramah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the Qibla. It was almost, if you go to Medina Munawwara, it's almost 180 degrees. So it's like a straight line. If you're facing this way, you now face the other way. Almost 180. So he had made the minbar in the other direction. What happened to the old minbar? That area was given a little bit of a roof, and it was raised slightly, and it was known as as-suffah. As-suffah meaning an area where the poor and those who don't have much, those who don't have a place to go, or the muhajirin who were still coming in, they would actually settle there for a while and stay and spend a lot of their time in ibadah and learning the religion and sacrificing for the pleasure of Allah. Inshallah, we will get to that at some stage. But this area was known as as-suffah. It now became the back of the masjid, yet it used to be the front of the masjid when the qibla was in the other direction. So this is one thing that had happened. One of the beauties, or one of the beautiful points of the changing of the Qibla, was that the Muslims wanted to liberate their own home city of Makkah. It was their city. They were, most of them were born in there. The Muhajirin, almost all of them, besides a few, were born in Makkah. And now they were facing Makkah. Allah explained to them the value of this house of Makkah aforetime. And now they were facing that direction. How could they face the direction of a place that is in the hands of their enemies? So it gave them all the more reason to want to go and be victorious in Makkah al-Mukarramah. You see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made their hearts incline towards going back and getting whatever belonged to them. Subhanallah. So this was one of the reasons of, or one of the benefits of the change of the Qibla. After that, in the same year in Sha'ban, fasting was prescribed. O you who believe, fasting is prescribed upon you in the same way it was prescribed upon those before you, in order that you may achieve piety. Verses were revealed. And mashallah, in the month of Ramadan, they fasted for the first time. And in the same month of Ramadan, the Battle of Badr took place in the month of Ramadan. 14 years after being driven out of their homes, 17th of, in fact, 14 years after revelation and prophethood, you now find these people were given the opportunity to face those who had persecuted them for so long. Also, what was made compulsory in the same year was Sadaqatul Fitr, what we know when we are opening our fast at the end of Ramadan, and we need to give out what is known as the Fitr. That was made, it was prescribed also in the second year of Hijrah. And Zakah became compulsory just after the month of Ramadan. This Battle of Badr, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Talha ibn Ubaidillah and Sa'id ibn Zayd towards the north in order to gather information of the caravan of Abu Sufyan that had gone up north. And these people, they passed by Abu Sufyan and they saw him. So they quickly sent a message to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina Munawwara, saying, this man is on his return. He is now coming back. With him are 40 men, 1,000 camels, and 50,000 dinars, which means he has a lot. Subhanallah. He has so much and a lot of merchandise. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made an announcement in Medina Munawwara. And that announcement was, who is ready to go out in order to face Quraysh? They are coming back with their caravan and we are going to face them. At that particular time, it was not compulsory for all of them to go out. Just like they went to face the previous caravans where they were not really very successful, this was also one of those. They did not intend a full-fledged war. They only intended to get part of the merchandise from the caravan that was returning. And so you find people started giving their names. And people were being vetted. What is the meaning of vetted? Vetted meaning, some people are known that this person's condition is good, he can come. Some people, they had certain matters that disallowed them from joining the battle. One of them was Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu. He was disallowed from joining the battle because his wife was ill and sick. The daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ruqayya radiallahu anha. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So this was a major battle, the decisive battle, the first major battle. And yet you have the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam telling certain people that go back and serve your parents. And certain people go back and serve your, meaning look after your family members. Because that is compulsory upon you as a person. And this year, it's compulsory upon us collectively. So if some of us go, the rest of us will not be penalized. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. The statement I have made is very important. We learn from this that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a system in place from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it worked like clockwork. And it resulted in the fact that today we are sitting in this masjid, subhanallah. So inshallah we will be going through the battle of Badr in detail starting from tomorrow. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us benefit until we meet again. Sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu.